Before I get into my lesson this morning, based upon this parable, I dissect this parable, and to be able to understand this parable, you have to know something about sheep. And when we look at the scripture, Jesus classifies us as sheep. And one thing about sheep, sheep are kept in a pen. One thing though now, and then the sheep always have to have a shepherd. Yes. Some people believe that the shepherd is everywhere. When you look back in the day, the shepherd was not here and there, the sheep here and there. Wherever the sheep was is where the shepherd protected the sheep. Now, I want y'all to follow me here now, because in verse number 6 of this, it says that people understood him not. Today, I'm going to ask the question, this is the problem today. People do not understand Jesus today. All right now, this passage begins the great revelation of Jesus as the shepherd of life. Jesus here is the picture as the only true shepherd of the sheep. In verse number 7, Jesus said this, that he was the gate of the sheep. He is probably referring to the gate here as a community or a community pastor, which houses all the sheep of an area. Now there is another description of Jesus as the gate, when the sheep were kept out in the hill country overnight. They were kept in ravenous, surrounded by several rock walls. The opening into the raven had no gate at all. The shepherd himself became the gate. During the night, he would lie across the opening. This is how sheep were back in the day. The shepherd was. The sheep, based upon the shepherd laying across the opening, the sheep could get out only by going over him.
Yes.
And the enemy of the sheep could get in, could not get in to the sheepfold. Only by going through him, based upon what are you saying, Harry? When the wolf come at the sheep, based upon the wall that they had built around the sheep, the enemy could not get in because the shepherd was laying across the opening. And based upon this opening, the only way the enemy could get in would have to come through the shepherd. Are y'all following me so far?
Yes.
Now watch it now. Let's go to the text. And let's look at verse number 1 of this parable. And let's see what Jesus is really saying here. What did he say?
Scripture reads, "Verily, verily, I say unto you."
Jesus said, "Verily, verily, I say unto you,
he that entereth not by the door of the sheepfold,
he that entereth not by the door of the sheepfold, but climbeth up some other way,
the same is a thief and a robber."
What is he saying, Jesus? Jesus began the parable with, "I tell you the truth." What he had to say to them, and also to us, is very important. He let us know the position, church, of salvation, of a spiritual sight that comes by believing Jesus Christ to be the Son of God, according to John 9:36-38. It is the position of being accepted by God, because we approach God only in the name of Jesus Christ. Yes. The sheep pen here, it symbolizes the place where the sheep are believers are kept. Well, where are they kept? In the church. Yes. In salvation. In spiritual sight. In the place of acceptance. They are kept here into eternal life. In spiritual deliverance from darkness. Into the position of faith. The whole parable has to do with a false shepherd and a true shepherd. Both of them are after the sheep. The true shepherd is Christ. And the false shepherd are those teachers who so blindly stood against his claim to be the light of the world. Those are the false shepherds that Jesus is talking about. Now watching that. Jesus said in John 8:12. Then, get it from me right quick. John 8:12. Let's look, because, now let's look at this. Then speak Jesus what?
Then speak Jesus again unto them.
Now Jesus is speaking again to him.
I am the light of the world.
He said, I am the light of the world.
He that follows me shall not walk in darkness. But shall have
the light of life. Jesus used the word light often. John used the word 24 times. What it meant by calling Jesus the light? Jesus is the light by nature. He is the light by essential. His essential. His character. Scripture says God is the light. Now, the sheep pen can be entered. There is a gate into the sheep pen, an entrance, a way to get in, and the gate is only acceptance. Way is to enter into the sheep pen. The only way that anybody can come into the sheep pen, you got to come through the gate. Jesus is the gate.
Yeah.
And I want to tell you something. He is the way. Some shepherds climb into the sheep pen by some other way. The word way is very important, church. Yeah. Some other direction. Some other position. Some other source. Or some other road. Now note also the term thief and a robber here. That's what he said, am I right? The very same word described Judas as a thief and my robbers as a robber. Yes. Now, that it is awesome. It's an awesome thing for a person to be put in the same opposite from Christ as a person could ever be, is to be called a thief and a robber. This is what's happening now. Everybody's telling me, I have the sheep pen. Come over here. People just saying, I have the way. Am I right this morning?
Yes.
Well, then, based upon the word of God, there's only one way.
Yes.
And that way is only through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Some people just climbing, they're climbing through the sheep pen, and they're not coming through the gate. Am I right, Richard? They're coming over the wall. They're not coming through Christ. What are they coming for? To steal and destroy.
Yes.
That's what's happening today.
Yes.
Watching that. A thief is a seducer and a deceiver. He's a crafty and dishonest person. A person who would use any means to get into the sheep pen to steal sheep. That's what a thief is. A robber is a person who will use violence and cruelty. They will destroy and devour if necessary to get into the sheep pen.
Yes.
God about a false shepherd. 1 Timothy 3:6-5. Titus 1:10-16. 2 Peter 2:1-22. I think about what John said in John 10:10. Let's look and see what John said here now. What did John say in John 10:10?
The thief cometh not but for to steal.
He said, now this is the only way the thief comes. He come but for to steal.
And to kill.
And to kill.
And to destroy.
And to destroy. But what did he say Jesus said? Jesus said, I
that
come.
They might have life.
Okay.
And that they might have it more abundant.
Jesus is saying here, I don't come to steal. I don't come to kill. He let us know I don't even come to destroy. He said, I'm come that you might have life. And that you may have it more abundantly. Jesus used the clear claim to his deity. He said, I am.
Yes.
He said, now, I am church. Yes. All right, now. What are you saying? This gives additional stress to his claim to be the only gate to God.
I am.
All us who claim to be the gate, he said, let me tell you, they're nothing but a thief and a robber. There are some who claim to be the gate and have the way to God. They claim to know the right way and to have the idea and the truth and the knowledge. They claim to have the right teaching. They say, we have the right religious. We have the right works. All right now. And say now, I am maturity. They claim to be the gate that opens into God's presence. Jesus said that they ain't nothing but a thief and a robber.
Yeah.
Life is one of the greatest words of the scripture, church. The word life and the verb to live or to have life. Let me tell you what life is. Life is energy. Life is force. It is the power of being. Life is the opposite of perishing. It is deliverance from condemnation and death. Life is eternal. It is the very life of God himself. John 17:3. Life is satisfaction. Life is found only in God. God is the source and the author of life. John 5:26. Life, church, have been redeemed. Am I right now? It have been unveiled and is clearly seen only in Christ Jesus. All right now. Because Christ shows us, church, what life is. Life only comes to a person who believes in Christ. A person outside Christ only exists just for a little while. Real life is found only in God. God is the creator of life. And the creator of life, he alone knows what life really is and what it's supposed to be. This is the reason he sent his son, Jesus Christ, into the world to show us what life is. When we look at Christ, we see exactly what life is. Where? What is life? Life is love. Life is joy. Love, life is peace. Life is patience. Life is kindness. Life is goodness. Life is faithful. Life is gentleness. And life is also self-control. I think now, let's go back to the text just for a little while and read verses 2 and 3 of John chapter 10. What did Jesus say here? He that entereth
in by the door
is the shepherd of the sheep.
to him the door to open it.
All right, now read on.
And the sheep hear his voice. And he called it his own sheep
by name.
And leadeth them out.
All right, now. What is he saying? Let me tell you. Jesus, this next point, Jesus is the true shepherd. Did y'all see what he's saying here? All right, now. The shepherd who entered the appointed gate is the true shepherd.
Yeah.
And that shepherd is Jesus Christ. Yeah. He knows where the gate is and the way into the sheep pen, which is the church.
Yeah.
All right, now. His purpose, church, is not to steal some sheep from the home of God and start a flock of his own.
Yeah.
Did you hear what I said?
Yeah.
He's not come to steal sheep from the own God or start a flock of his own. That's what's wrong in the world today.
Yeah.
Am I right now?
Yeah.
Okay, now, what are they doing? They're stealing sheep from God.
Yeah.
They started their own flock. Am I right now? Okay, now, why is it you got a church over here, you got a church over there, you got a church here, there? Am I right now?
Mm-hmm.
They all say we are the way into God's presence. God authorized only one.
One shepherd. One flock.
You know what? They are teaching reverse things from God's will. Am I right?
That's right?
If you can't find it in the Bible, you better get away. God only have one.
Yes.
And he's not the author of confusion. That's what's wrong today. Everybody teaching different doctrine. And now, am I right now? The Bible said, how can two walk together unless in their agreement? All right now. You know what? Because they're teaching different things.
Mm-hmm.
I'm right. Mm-hmm. I know I'm right. Let's go a little deep into this. That's right. You know what? They did not understand this part. Like they don't understand today. Am I right?
Mm-hmm.
They don't understand.
Mm-hmm.
Listen to this.
What do you mean? Like an oak.
The shepherd.
Like an oak.
Here. He goes and focus upon the sheep and the honor of will to serve him and to do God's will. That's what Jesus came to do. Do the will of God. The shepherd entered the sheep pen by the gate. The gate was made for him.
Yeah.
And the sheep to enter.
Yeah.
Therefore, he uses it. Y'all hear me? The shepherd is known by the watchman, God, or the Holy Spirit. The shepherd is not afraid to face the watchman, God, or the Holy Spirit. One thing, the point is critical here, church. The Holy Spirit as God who come is the one who come to the gate is known by the watchman. Christ is watching his church. I'm going to get to the church in a minute. I'm going to show y'all something. See? Watch this. He's known by the shepherd. He's not afraid to face the watchman. Watch this. Let's go to John 10 and 15. Watch this. God don't know the mother. What's my name?
He knows the son.
Watch this. You know what he said?
He said, as the Father knoweth me.
He said, as the Father knoweth me.
Even so know I
know
the
Father.
And I lay down my
life
for the sheep.
Look what he said now. Look what he did for. He said now, the Father know me. And I know the Father. I want to tell you the reason why I'm the true shepherd. Because I lay down my life down for the sheep. Can y'all see that this morning? All right, now. Jesus laid his life down for us. type of new in sheep individual. Mm-hmm. Even in large herds, the Lord knows each of his sheep by name. The word is his name, his own, mean he called his own. No, as a whole, no, not as a herd, but he calls us individually. The shepherd, the Lord Jesus Christ, let me tell you something. He knows each and every one of us. He said in John 10 and 14, he said, I am the good shepherd. He says, and I know my sheep, and I'm known of mine. The shepherd leads the sheep. Amen. He leads his sheep. He loves them as his own. He must lead them to the green pasture and still water. He must see that they are nurtured and protected and given the very best care possible. According to Matthew 6:34, he feeds the sheep even if they, and he has to gather them in his arms and carry them to the pasture. Isaiah 40, verse number 11. He guides the sheep to the pasture and away from the rough places. Psalms 23:1-4. He seeks and saves the sheep that goes lost. According to Matthew 11:12. He protects the sheep. He even sacrifices his life for the sheep. John 10:11. He restores the sheep who go astray and return them back to the sheep pen. 1 Peter 2:25. He rewards the sheep for obedience and faithfulness. 1 Peter 5:4. All right now. He said in John 10:17-18. Therefore do my Father love me because I lay down my life that I might take it again. Verse number 18, he said, no man take it in from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have the power to lay it down, and I have the power to take it back again. This commandment have I received of my Father. Let me tell you something. Look what he said. I got the power. Let me tell you, we serve a Christ that has the power. I'm going to tell you something. Let me go just a little bit more here, because I'm going to have to give you my conclusion in a minute. This is the final proof that Jesus is the good shepherd. It is his sacrifice, death, and his resurrection. A sheep, a shepherd, could do no more greater good than to give his life for a sheep. A shepherd who dies for a sheep was beyond questioning. A good shepherd, there's someone else. Here's where the owner was pleased, deeply accepts him, that the shepherd gave his life for the flock here. Y'all know what? I want to tell you something. The owner counted the shepherd to be a good shepherd. Jesus' sacrifice, death, was the very reason God loved his son so much. This does not mean that God does not love his son just because of what he did. He loved his son just as any person would love their child.
Yes.
God loved Jesus even more.
Yes.
In a much more special way, because Jesus willingly to pay such a price to bring people to God. Let me tell you something. I got more in there, but that's enough. I don't want to give you too much, but I got this something else I want to say. God prophesies in Isaiah 2:2. Watch this now. Watch it now. I'm going to show you something.
All right.
What did he say?
Is that an answer shall come to pass?
Wait a minute, they shall come to pass.
In the last day.
In the last day.
That the mountain of the
Get Hebrew one more.
Shall be established in the top of the mountain.
Hold on, sir. in Hebrews 1:1. He said that in the last days. Well, where are we living now? There have been three dispensations of time. You had the patriarchal. God spoke through the fathers. And then you got the Mosaic age, which you call the law of Moses. God spoke through the prophets. Am I right? Well, then what did he say in Hebrews 1:1?
God, who at sundry times and in divers manner speak in the past unto the fathers.
Oh, that's a father. All right, now then by the prophet. But what did he say? But now, in the last day, he's speaking to us through his son, Jesus Christ. Now he's getting ready to speak to us now. He going to speak through Jesus. Now what did, now go ahead and read Isaiah 2:2.
Isaiah said this shall come to pass.
Isaiah said this shall come to pass.
That the mountain
of the Lord's house
shall be established, in the mountain,
in the top of the mountain.
And it shall be exalted.
And it shall be exalted
above
the hill. And all nations shall flow into it. And many people shall say, come.
And many people shall go and say,
say, come ye,
let us go up to the mountain of the Lord,
of the Lord's house,
to the house
of the God of Jacob.
Jacob.
Let me go ahead.
And he will teach us
of his ways.
And we will walk in his path. For out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem.
Wait a minute. Michael said, wait a minute. Isaiah said, Michael chapter 4. Yeah, almost identical, the same language. Now these are prophecy. That he prophesies the future. People hollering at prophet. You don't even know what a prophet is. But anyway, a prophet is somebody that God revealed through them to prophesy the future. Yes. And this is future tense. Now, Isaiah said, all nations shall flow into it. Am I right, Jim?
Right.
Michael chapter 4, you have almost identical, the same language. Michael said, all people shall flow into it. You got IT and IT. Let's go to the book of Matthew. 16, pick me up. Right about verse number 13. Jesus, we said when he came in the coast of Caesarea and Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? They said, some say,
John the Baptist.
John the Baptist.
Some Elijah.
Elijah.
Some Jeremiah.
Some Jeremiah.
One of the prophets.
Wait a minute. They said John the Baptist doesn't come back alive. Herod done beheaded John in chapter 14. They call him Jeremiah. Jeremiah been dead over 400 years. And they call him Elijah. Elijah. You know why they call him Elijah? Because God said one is going to come and lead the way for him. Well, he said he's going to come in the form of Elijah. That's John the Baptist. That's what Jesus let them know. John wore what Elijah wore. He ain't what Elijah ain't. John is the one that makes the way for Christ. Now, anyway, now read on.
He said to them.
Now he said.
But who do you
say? Who do you say that I am?
Simon Peter.
Hold on 1 second. He said, some say. Some is still saying that today. Some say. And all of the psalm is wrong. But he had Simon Peter. But who do you say that I am? What did he say?
Simon answered
and said. He answered and said,
you are the Christ.
You are the Christ.
The Son of the living God.
Son of the living God. Okay. Now watch it now. Now watch this. Now. What did he tell Simon?
Jesus answered and said to him, blessed are you,
Simon. Blessed are thou, Simon, but Jonah. Except for
what? Flesh and blood.
Did not reveal him unto thee. Hold on a minute. What he's saying? No man. Reveal this unto you. But who did he say?
But my Father.
He said, didn't nobody do it but God. Who is in heaven? Now watch this now. Now based upon what Peter confessed and said, he was the Christ. Now Jesus is finna tell him something. Now watch this now. He said, upon this word, upon this rock, hold on a second. Don't misunderstand the word rock here. The word rock here means that based upon your confession, Peter, that And based upon your conviction, I'm going to tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to build me a shoot pin.
Yes.
Make that noise.
Isn't that what he's saying?
Yes.
Look like it. I'm going to build a church.
Yes.
Who church? My church, people. And then he said, what else? He said, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. I'm going to tell you something. What he's saying, he's going to build it in future tense. He got to die.
Yes.
First. I'm going to tell you something this morning. Don't ever tell you something. Don't let people cause you to miss the boat. I know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
I was raised up in a denomination. I fought it for years. You know why? Because I was unlearned.
Yes.
He said, I'm going to build my church. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against them. Yes. There you get again. Now watch what he's going to do for Peter. What did he say?
And I would give
he said, I'm going to give you some, Peter.
The key of the kingdom.
I'm going to give you the keys of the kingdom.
Of heaven.
Of heaven. That's the church.
Yes.
And whatsoever
you bound on earth,
be bound in heaven.
Bound in heaven.
You shall lose on earth, shall be loosed in heaven. The only way that you can be saved, you got to do what who Peter said. What he's saying, Peter, I'm going to give you the authority.
Yeah.
It's not your church, Peter.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. All I'm doing is giving you some authority.
Right.
Yeah. To be. And when I give you the authority, Peter, now if I give you this authority, who got to preach the first sermon?
Peter.
Watch how God's word flows. In Acts chapter 2, when the 12 came together on the day of Pentecost, Peter stood up amongst the 11. This is what he said, you men of Judea took with your wicked hands, crucified the Son of God. This same Jesus whom you crucified, God have made him both Lord and Christ. They was pricked in their heart. And as men, brother, what shall we do? Peter said, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And it says over 3,000 was added, not joined.
Added
to the church daily, such as should be saved. Church, I'm going to tell you something. I'm going to tell y'all something. God only authorized Christ to build a church. And it's his sheep pen. That's where he keeps his sheep. I'm going to tell you something. Ephesians 4 and 4 said there is one body. Colossians 1 and 18 and 24 said the body is the church. It ain't go on. Jesus, I'm going to tell you something. If you want to come in contact with Jesus' blood, you got to get into the church. Just like physically, body. The only way I can come in contact with folks' blood, I'm going to cut you out of. That's the only way. This is spiritual. The only way you can come in contact with Christ's blood and be forgiven for your sin, you got to become a member of the church. You don't have to believe me. But you don't have to believe me. Believe what the word of God
says.
That's the word of God.
Amen.
That's right. People, I'm not down in churches, but I'm going to tell you something. John the Baptist didn't build no church. Peter didn't build no church. All of these other people didn't build no church. Catholic. Watch this. They believe in the priest. You go. Confess your. Wait a minute. I'm going to tell you something. Before you could even become a priest under the law, you had to come from the Levite tribe. We all a royal priest. I don't have to go to nobody and confess my sin. I don't know how to eat myself. Jimmy, you got to go to somebody to confess your sin. Somebody, outside me going to him, he may need to be coming to me. And ask me to pray for him. Jesus said this, call no man father.
Amen.
You know why? Now, he's talking about spiritually. We have a physical father and a spiritual father. I only have one spiritual father. And that's God.
Yes.
I don't say it enough. I just got to tell the truth.
Amen.
people didn't understand. But y'all should understand. Jesus said, the words I speak unto you with judgment. Acts 20:28. Paul said, feed the church of God, which he had purchased with his own blood. We know that was Jesus Christ. Paul said this. Feed it. He said, I know after my departing, grievous wolves is going to enter in the sheep pen to draw away disciples after me.
Yeah.
Am I right?
Yeah.
He said, I see not the one that night and day, the wolf is out here, church.
Yeah.
Don't let him get you.
Yeah.
Stay in God's house.
Yeah.
Worship God. Serve him to the day you die. I done said enough. If you're here, we'll baptize you today. God will add you to his church. His own church. And if you actually, if you have faith, if you have slipped away from the sheep, I am the word. God is a forgiving God. They say that one go astray.
No.
And you leave the 99 and go get your one. He said, when you bring them back, the angels in heaven rejoice. And one is baptized and one is added to the church. We're going to bring one up. Why don't you come as we stand and sing the song? No.